This evening will be failure, fear of failure. Very inspiring, I'm sure about it. Our guest, Esther van Venema, standing over there, is a psychiatrist. She's also a well-known opinion maker. You can find her on Twitter. She writes columns and articles for newspapers and for magazines. And she is a professional violin player. That's why she's standing with her violin on stage. She recently set up a political party, Beter NL, a one-issue party. Oh no, that one is occupied, I'm sure, for our students. a political party focusing on health. Tonight it will be about mental health. Fears of failure. The anguish not to be able to pass an exam. Or to find the right English words, in my case. Or to deliver a speech. Esther will highlight these fears of failures of musicians to perform on stage. She's founder of the Muziekpoli in Leiden. Currently, it's called the Performance Poli. And that's a clinic for musicians who have fear to perform on stage. She wrote this book about it, Het ontstemde brein. She will also do some citations from this book. And it's very well written. Almost everything which is inside this book and which she will tell us tonight can also be applied to us, non-musicians who have or who may have some fears of failure. I'm glad to give the floor to Esther van Venema.
Thanks, Hiska, for this very elegant words. Thank you so much. And thank you for the opportunity to share some of my experiences as a psychiatrist and a musician with you tonight. I'm a psychiatrist working with musicians, but also with actors and CEOs, people who perform on stage. And I have done that for over 10 years now. And I would like to start, because I promised Hiska to play some violin. I tried to escape that, but she didn't let me. So perhaps we should start the night by emphasizing the importance of emotions expressed by music. Is that an idea? And then, let's start with some basic emotions. I will improvise, and then we have an idea about what words, language, music might have in common with each other or where they differ. So who can shout the first emotion I should try to express on my violin?
Despair.
Despair. Okay, nice. Yeah. To start with, huh? Some other emotion. Balance. I'm just improvising. Eh?
Balance. Balancing.
Balancing. Is that an emotion? Let's see what happens. So one last emotion, a bit less abstract.
Joy.
Okay, yeah. Thank you. And now I will perform a short fragment of real composers. And I do that because I would like to, well, to show you what the complexity of real music, real composers, can add to our emotional spectrum. I will tell you later what I did. What emotions did you observe, feel, experience? Uncertainty?
Tension.
Again?
Tension,
yeah. Sure, yeah. And a bit of despair as well, no? It's very personal. So another one. What do you think?
Sadness.
Heartbreak, sadness. It's Bach.
Melancholic,
yeah, that's a nice word, yeah. So the last fragment that was Bach, and the first was the beginning of the Tzigane of Maurice Ravel. That's one of my favorite pieces. So Hiska, is that enough music for tonight? We have to start with the presentation. Okay. We're not going to talk solely about musicians and music, but also about the brain and some basic functions I would like to share with you. And perhaps we can discuss some themes about it afterwards. So over the last 10 years, I worked with the musicians, and I have to conclude that the musician is his profession. Unlike other professions like lawyers or doctors or you name it, there is only the music for the musician. So when there is a problem in performing, or there's performance anxiety, for example, then this is really a disaster, because the musician doesn't have many hobbies or other escape routes to go to. So, and when musicians go to, standard caregivers, they have the problem that they are often overvalued. So they come with performance anxiety, and this, for example, doctor, psychiatrist will say, like, but how is it possible? Because you are paid for doing your hobby, in fact, so how can you be anxious? And on the other side, you see this undervaluation, like, well, if that's such a problem to go on stage, why you don't look for another profession then? And both reactions are really not constructive when a musician is fighting with this kind of psychiatric problems. And, well, the musician is his profession, so the margins within functioning are very, very tight. With normal patients, let's say that they exist, you can say, well, go back home, maybe you should work half days instead of full time to recover from your depression. But I had this violinist, and he was a young, talented guy, and he was really depressed, and he was about to go on tour to Russia. And I had to be very unorthodox as a psychiatrist, and I told him, well, I advise you to go on tour, because if you take away this music from these patients, there's a big risk of regression and of really deterioration of the clinical situation, in fact. And on the other hand, We have medication with side effects on the playing, on the motor skills, and on the emotional expression. And I think it's important to be cautious about that. Well, in 2008, I started this outpatient clinic, and I had a few, objectives. As I'm a musician and a psychiatrist, I think it's important to, give that little bit of extra. I wanted awareness and early detection of problems in this high-functioning group of people, specific diagnostics, and of course treatment advice, and in general, I'm really fighting the taboo on mental issues still in the Netherlands in 2019. Do you recognize that, the taboo on mental issues? It shouldn't be like that, but we still have to fight it, and I'm concerned, and I hope you will help me with that. Until now, I've seen a few hundred patients. As Hiska told me, not only musicians are prone to performance anxiety, but also CEOs, scientists, top sporters, actors, etc. But I have to say that performance anxiety was in 60% more or less the reason to ask for consultation. We did some scientific research. We compared the first 50 patients of this outpatient clinic with the normal psychiatric patients. I hate this word, but okay. And see what are the differences between musicians and normal psychiatric patients. And we found two striking results. First is that despite really mental suffering, as you can see on questionnaires, where musicians had the same kind of suffering as the normal patients, we found out that they stay functioning in a much higher level, like top sporters. And well, that's in some way it's a positive thing, but on the other way, we have to be careful because mental problems, they can be harder to treat if you wait too long for seeking help and to come back to your normal functioning in the end. This one is also very interesting. Narcissism we often use as a bad word to say, I don't like you, you're a narcissist or something. But it's a personality trait. It's not a personality disorder, but it can be a trait. And the interesting thing is that it's 50% genetic. And the other 50% is caused by your upbringing, induced by that. And we see in this musician population that the upbringing is often very strongly focused on achievements. Mommy and daddy only like you when you do this perfect performance on stage. And the result of that is a narcissistic personality, structure, let's say, where there is the self-image not so much solid and decent, but inflated, grandiose, etc., which make that people are more at risk for developing depression and anxiety disorders because they are vulnerable, in fact. If you perform not well enough, it has a huge impact on your self-image. And if you are genetically vulnerable, for example, depression, it can cause depressive disorder. And on the other hand, I think narcissistic personality traits are interesting, and I think you need it as a performer also, because who are you to go on stage, for example, and to play again this Mendelssohn violin concerto? It has been played 1,000 times, so what can you add to it? I think you need a certain amount of narcissism to do that kind of crazy things. When patients come to my clinic, during the first appointment, I always ask, what's the meaning of music to you? And they are not allowed to think too long about it. They have to answer right away. And I get these fantastic answers, like, music is my mother tongue. Who am I if I do not make music? I cannot live without music. It's everything I have. I can only express myself by music. It's me. So imagine if that's the real true answer, which always strikes me, and then you are not able to perform. That's really terrible. So let's talk a bit on music. Because there is a lot of not too well scientific research on the function of music. Why do we have music? Does it have an evolutionary purpose? Is it kind of complex language, blah, blah, blah? I think that might be true, of course, but in the past decade, I found out that music is actually very essential to channel emotions for people, for musicians, maybe for all of us, that cannot be really tolerated or accepted in the normal life. For example, this cellist who can only experience really sadness by playing Elgar cello concerto. I don't know if you know it, but it can be really sad in some parts of it. Because his father, when he was young, did not tolerate when he was sad, because a man should not be sad. Another example is a girl, and she can only play really, when she plays this really terrible music, it's like Shostakovich, for example, that's the way how she can, process, experience rage or really anger, because when she was a little girl and she became angry, her mother got a headache. So she learned not to be too angry because it was too dangerous, because she didn't want her mother to have a headache. So music is a very safe channel for emotions. Also, music is very healthy for your brain. There is a study where they followed 44 subjects, and they were busy making music from 0 to 26 years. And the people who were making music for a longer time, listening, but especially making music, they had different brain areas. The increase of the hippocampus was significant. The hippocampus, important for memory functions in your brain. But also the frontal lobe, which is important for overview and planning, there was a significant increase when making music. And also Erik Scherder and Dick Swaap, they wrote both brilliant books on music and how very healthy it is. How many of you do make music yourselves? That's a lot. Very healthy. And we also induce with music some fine neurochemicals. The reward system is stimulated in the same way as success can do drugs, sex. And it's interesting that the goosebumps effect when you listen to music, you can block that by opiate antagonist, which is used also to block the effects of heroin and morphine. So that's interesting. But also endorphin is induced by listening to music. They did this research with patients with burns, and when they were taking care of changing their wounds, etc. That's not good English, but you know what I mean. When there was music, there was significantly less pain medication needed in order to help them. And we have all these stress hormones, which are important to survive. Adrenaline, I will come back to that later, but also cortisol. And when listening to music, the cortisol blood level is lower. And I think that's important. It's only a research phenomena. We don't use it in daily practice yet. And cortisol is a stress hormone, which is also negatively associated with depression and with anxiety disorders. So that's interesting. And when we sing together in a group around the fire, we have an increase of the cuddle hormone in the popular media of oxytocin. So that's a good idea to think. I'm suggesting that we have this very expensive KPMG, Berenschot kind of consultancy companies. But I think when you, in your company, just sit together every morning, start singing with each other, I think that might really do something. And then another result is the influence on sex hormones. Women are more interested in sex when listening to music, and men are less aggressive. And I'm still wondering how we can use that in our society, if we should do something with that. Maybe you have ideas about that. But more abstract, music also induces the flow. And the flow is a very vague concept, but every musician and everyone who is into music knows what I'm talking about. It's the connection you can sometimes, once in a while, experience the connection with your surroundings, the environment, the universe, and with each other. I remember when I studied on a conservatory in Amsterdam, at night you had this few hours left to practice for the exam the next morning, and I locked myself into a room, I switched off the light, it was dark, and I started playing Bach. And this was a kind of flow moment where you feel so connected and in peace with the world around you, but also with the people around you in the orchestra, for example, giving it this very special experience where you feel connected to every member around you. Is anyone experienced with the flow? Yeah. Does it make sense what I tell you about it? You recognize it, but it's hard to explain, no? Yeah. Other people? Flow? I see some nodding. The retrieval is another one interesting. Retrieval is the ability of music to activate very complex emotions and to connect them in the past with the present. You can say it's the Marcel Proust phenomenon. In his book, A la recherche du temps perdu, the main character experienced this very specific retrieval moment when eating a cookie, a madeleine, put in some tea, and this smell activates all the emotions of some very specific beautiful moments in his youth. The retrieval. And the attribution is also interesting because we all have our specific taste when it comes to music, and there is not such a thing as the best music because it's very different. There is one, it depends on the associations that your brain make in your upbringing with the music and certain situations. There's this famous film Death and the Maiden of Roman Polanski. And Death and the Maiden is also Der Tod und das Mädchen, a famous string quartet from Schubert. And she was raped for many years, and her rapist put on every time that he raped her this Tod und Mädchen from Schubert. So when she hears the first notes, she gets traumatized again, and she is traumatized, but she gets all these symptoms activated immediately. That's her attribution to that piece of music. And now I would like to show you some experiment they did with Oliver Sacks, this famous neurologist. Unfortunately, he passed away. And well, let's have a look inside his brain, what happens when he listens to music.
The well-known writer and neurologist Oliver Sacks is exploring the idea of how the brain reacts to music. He is trying to figure out why some brains can't decode music at all, while others are sensitive to the slightest musical nuance.
In general, I'm a Bach lover and have always been, you know, even when I was a kid, when I was five, I'm told that I was asked what my favorite things in the world were, and I said smoked salmon and Bach. Mm. And 70 years later, it's still pretty much the same.
In his quest, Dr. Sacks is offering himself up as a test subject. A team of neuroscientists at Columbia University have designed a test that will reveal if the brain of Dr. Sacks loves Bach as much as he does.
And roll back and forth.
Hal Hinkle gives Dr. Sacks a device to rate his emotions, while at the same time, a scan will record the activity of his brain. He'll hear two pieces of music, one by Bach and one by Beethoven. First the Bach, then the Beethoven. The composers are different, but the music shares certain qualities.
Oliver, that completes the first emotional scan. I would like to hear how that was for you.
The Bach sort of blew me away, especially that point where the soprano came in and there was a wonderful harmonic modulation.
The results of the scan amazingly seem to confirm his feelings.
What you can see just in an immediate overview here is that this is your Bach brain and this is your Beethoven brain.
Sorry, Ludwig.
Yeah, sorry, Ludwig. There's not much there.
Bach clearly excited much of his brain, including the many regions essential to appreciating the complexity of music. But unlike...
Yeah, sorry, Ludwig. It's interesting, no? To see, really see what music can activate, all these areas, his, well, emotional brain parts like the amygdala, the sensory cortex, it's incredible. Well, that's one of the interesting functions of music as well, that it activates so many parts of your brain and let them interact. The motoric skills, cognitive skills, emotions, and I think that's also something healthy. But let's talk about stress, because it's a very relevant topic in our nowadays society. But I want you to understand a bit about stress, like what's the brain and stress has to do with each other. So let's have a look. This is the human function curve. In order to perform optimal, you have to stay in the optimum of this curve. And when you go to the right side, well, that's the so-called hyperstress, too much adrenaline impact on your functioning, trembling, shaking, and it's hard to keep control when performing on a stage. And here you see this man walking in the woods, and he encounters a snake. And in order to survive, our brain has this fast pathway to scan for danger. And the visual input is sent immediately to what I said, the panic button, the amygdala, emotional button, let's say. And there is the option to activate the fight, flight, and freeze reaction. That's very, very fast. But there's also this slower cognitive pathway. And, well, that will enable this person to think, well, it's just a little harmless snake, and the chance is very big that I will survive this. But with performers on stage, in particular musicians, when this fast pathway is activated too much, too quick, and there's so much fear, then you have no benefit from these slow cognitive pathways, because this fear is really about surviving, and it's hard to deal with that. And then it's interesting to talk about beta blockers, because that's an important drug in the performing world. Well, originally it has been developed for cardiovascular diseases to lower blood pressure, etc. And it's also used when performing on stage, because the white cubes, in fact, they block the transmission of adrenaline to the body, the signal, and it really blocks the trembling, the shaking, the dry mouth, all the effects, physical effects of fear mediated by adrenaline. So it's an interesting drug. I think that one in three musicians will use it once or in a longer time during their lives. It's not addictive physically, but psychologically I see people who get addicted and really need to take it before they do anything on a stage or with other people listening to them. And that's not without dangers, because long-term use of high doses can, well, have a risk for sugar diabetics and more side effects. The most striking fragment on performing under huge stress is a fragment of pianist Maria João Pires. And luckily she was filmed during a lunch concerto in the Concertgebouw, and she was expecting another concerto. But she is such an incredible performer that despite this really big shock, she is able to play.
Mahler was a great Mozart conductor. Shocked because she was expecting us to play another concerto. So when I started the first bar of the D minor concerto, she kind of jumped and panicked, like an electric shock, I think. And she couldn't consider even moving ahead playing, you know. And then we talked a moment, and she told me I was expecting to play a completely different piece. I do what I can do if I remember. And the miracle is that she has such a memory that she could, within a minute, switch to a new concerto without making one mistake.
So I hope whenever you're performing and you're anxious about it, think about this incredible fragment. I mean, this is what our brain obviously is capable of doing. Aren't you impressed? Yeah. We also conducted some research in Leiden at the Leiden University Medical Hospital, and we invited Lavinia Meyer, a famous Dutch harp player, very experienced, international prizes, and we used her in fact for an experiment, and while she was giving a concert we were measuring some parameters like heart frequency, blood pressure, and we also took away some blood for cortisol measurements. And it was interesting because, well, she was well prepared, she knows how to give a concert, but the biology of performing of stress is very specific because her heart rate was 160 beats per minute, where it is normally, what, let's say 80 beats per minute. And also her cortisol levels were sky high elevated. So that learns us, and it has been replicated by many other research groups as well, that under stress our biology changes, and it's important to know that, because that also is an argument to say that musicians, performers, that they function between very small margins, and that it's, well, it's delicate, this balance. And let's go to my favorite organ, because when we talk about stress, there's a lot of research indicating that our upbringing is really crucial for how we deal, how we process stress later on in our lives. And there was this experiment with newborn rats, and they were briefly separated from their mother during the first week of their lives. And they had altered in a negative way stress response for the rest of their lives. And the opposite was confirmed by intensive licking of this mother rat. And then you see, well, that reduces the stress reactivity during the later lives of these rats. And I think you can transfer that results to human beings, as have been proved as well. So that's called the epigenetics, in fact. The DNA is not static. There are these carbon caps, and I say it very briefly now. And that's determining which genes become active during the rest of your life. And this licking of mama rat, obviously, is very important to modulate this kind of gene activity. And I often wonder, why do we have a brain? Nowadays, we use it to reserve a table in a restaurant and to book a holiday in time, etc. But I think we have a brain to survive, which is a very open door to say so. But there is this scientist, Karel Friston, and he formulates it actually very interesting, that we have to process information better and better every time in order to have better chances to survive. And that is something our brain does, so by reducing the prediction errors of our brain, and in fact to minimize the chaos or the entropy, and doing so by combining the expectations of events based on previous experiences with the available information in the brain and our sensory information. That's a very complex process constructing how we perceive the world and how we feel and act, etc. And I think that's an important base for the field I'm working in, psychiatry. And there is this, I don't know if you know him, Anil Seth. He's a very famous neuroscientist from Great Britain. And in fact, he says, I think I agree with him, we are all hallucinating all the time. And when we agree about our hallucination, we call it reality. Am I shocking anybody now? There's this fragment where he, well, kind of illustrates this bold statement with an interesting experiment I would like to share with you. Yeah. Not just tripping, but also patients I see on a daily basis with psychosis. I have this patient who was terrified because he was persecuted by the color red. And when you see this simulation based on Google Deep Dream by inflating in fact triggers that cause the perception of dogs, you see that there is a filtering problem which really, really fucks up your reality, let's say it boldly. So, and the same principle of construction is valid for emotions, because we have this tendency to think that emotions are built in and that emotions are static and, well, you have to deal with it. But also that is not true. Our brain creates emotions based on previous experiences and all the beliefs and ideas that, well, we take with us from those events. And we have the opportunity to change our emotions. And I think that's very interesting, connecting to the, well, fear of failure, performing on stage and stress theme. And I have the last YouTube fragment, and then I'll leave you alone. And that's Lisa Feldman Barrett, and she's a professor of psychology, and actually tells in a bit the same way about emotions, talks.
And so the lesson here is that emotions which seem to happen to you are actually made by you. You are not at the mercy of mythical emotion circuits which are buried deep inside some ancient part of your brain. You have more control over your emotions than you think you do. I don't mean that you can just snap your fingers and, you know, change how you feel the way that you would change your clothes. But your brain is wired so that if you change the ingredients that your brain uses to make emotion, then you can transform your emotional life. So if you change those ingredients today, you're basically teaching your brain how to predict differently tomorrow. And this is what I call being the architect of your experience. So here's an example. All of us have had a nervous feeling before a test, right? But some people experience crippling anxiety before a test. They have test anxiety. Based on past experiences of taking tests, their brains predict a hammering heartbeat, sweaty hands, so much so that they are unable to actually take the test. They don't perform well, and sometimes they not only fail courses, but they actually might fail college. But here's the thing. A hammering heartbeat is not necessarily anxiety. It could be that your body is preparing to do battle and ace that test, or, you know, give a talk in front of hundreds of people on a stage where you're being filmed. I'm serious. And research shows that when students learn to make determination, right, energize, this kind of energized determination instead of anxiety, they perform better on tests. And that determination seeds their brain to predict differently in the future so that they can get their butterflies flying in formation. And if they do that often enough, they not only can pass a test, but they will be, it'll be easier for them to pass their courses, and they might even finish college.
Isn't that fascinating? I think it's really, really interesting that we have much more control over our brain and the processes and the, well, experiences, in fact, than we think. Which doesn't imply that I think you should have always the top experience living your life, because life is also about, well, failure and about disappointment and stuff like that. But it's more a technical approach I would like to share with you. So when we see this brain interacting with the environment, we better can understand the origin of psychiatric disorders. And we have our, I will come to that, our specific labels, etc. But I would like to understand what's going on. And, well, there is no such set of disorders like psychiatric disorders who are so much, the consequence of the interaction of your brain with the environment, with the surroundings. It's, well, fundamentally characterized by disturbed interactions between people and their environment. That's where the problem, the origin of the problems, in fact. So let's say to go to anxiety disorders, when I'm in a supermarket and I experience a panic attack while waiting in the queue to pay my groceries, there is no threat, there is no life and death danger, but my brain obviously, well, catches some cues or triggers and activates this panic button and, well, causes an inadequate reaction with a lot of dysfunctioning in the end. And with autism is also an interesting disorder. Children with autism, they are unable to correctly interpret the emotions of the other people. It's also an interaction problem. And the same with psychosis, as you saw. In fact, the inability to properly filter signals coming in and giving the right meaning in your brain and reacting to that. I can talk for hours about it, but we have only 50 minutes, so it's a bit, well, concerning. So the origin of mental problems is interesting to talk about because we all, well, have this tendency to be sometimes depressed a few days or a bit anxious or locking, well, to check if we lock the doors a few times extra if we're under stress. And mental problems actually, well, that's the same as with cardiovascular problems. If you have this genetic predisposition, there's a lot of cardiovascular risk in your family running, and you have this very unhealthy lifestyle, the risk for a heart attack is elevated. And the same is with mental problems. There is this genetic predisposition very often, and the amount of stress in combination with this predisposition will tell you if you get a depressive episode, a psychosis, an anxiety attack, etc. And as I said, the environmental factors, they are important. In musicians, there is a lot of stress. It's very irregular, stressful working environment, a lot of concurrence, and you have to perform every night, on sky-high level, otherwise you're done. And we have this official definition of mental disorders, and there are two important factors. There's this distress or disability or dysfunctioning, and the increased risk of really suffering. And the suffering is, of course, very subjective, but when you see a patient with a really severe depression, you know immediately what I talk about, because this suffering is enormous. Or with a psychosis, with a patient who is, well, thinking that he's persecuted by all kinds of intelligences and that he will die in a few days. I mean, it's like having this nightmare, but we wake up, and these people, they don't wake up. It's their life. We have several disorders. I think most of you, they know what we talk about, the mood disorders, depression, bipolar disorder, manic depressive combination, the anxiety disorders, the performance anxiety, the fear of failure. Well, if it's really compromising your functioning, we can categorize that as an anxiety disorder. Psychotic disorders, substance abuse, ADHD, and personality disorders. And the last category is complicated because that's, well, the special pattern, how you deal with yourself and your environment, in fact, and it's a pattern which is very stable over the time. So think about the borderline personality disorder, for example, causing a lot of trouble for the people itself, but also for their loved ones. And then the performance anxiety. It's a typical mental injury for people performing on stage. And I would like to see it like that and not as a sign of weakness or something, because that's very unprofessional and incorrect. And it's, as I explained to you, associated with predisposition and the amount of stress in your life. And it's not associated with your level as a performer, as a scientist, as an actor, etc., because that's a misunderstanding I would like to contradict. Unfortunately, I will switch to Dutch, because I will read about my first panic attack myself. Am I compromising a lot of English-speaking people here? Maybe they can translate to you after if I said something interesting or not. In die tijd woonde ik in een achterbuurt in Rotterdam. Ik combineerde twee studies, geneeskunde en conservatorium. Geneeskunde in Utrecht en Brussel was het conservatorium. Ik had bij een vriendin een kamer gevonden. Het stelde niet veel voor. Ik sliep op een zolderkamer met mijn bezittingen die in een dozijn dozen pasten met daartussen een matras. En in die periode ervoer ik zelf veel stress vanwege mijn onthechte bestaan, gedoe met relaties, de druk die ik mezelf oplegde om te presteren en veel conflicten met mijn ouders. Ik dacht dat mensen mij alleen zouden waarderen als ik de lat extreem hoog legde. Om tijdens mijn studies in mijn levensonderhoud te kunnen voorzien was schnabbelen noodzakelijk. Van met kwartet het uitstrijkje achtergrondmuziek verzorgen tijdens een tuinfeest in Wassenaar, tot optredens in verzorgingstehuizen en meespelen in variété-orkesten zoals dat van Helmoet Lotti. De eerste paniekaanval tijdens een van deze schnabbels overviel me als een donderslag bij heldere hemel. Na de eerste maten merkte ik opeens dat het geluid om mij heen vervormde. Mijn armen en handen leken zich te vervreemden van de rest van mijn lichaam. Ik verstijfde en wilde tegelijkertijd opspringen om van het podium af te stormen. Dat was natuurlijk geen optie. Ik keek om me heen en zag dat iedereen rustig doorspeelde, terwijl voor mij de wereld leek te vergaan. Mijn hart bonste in mijn keel, het koude zweet brak me uit en ik leek geen controle meer te hebben over mijn lichaam en vooral niet over mijn strijkstok. Een echte horrorervaring. Ik klampte me vast aan de mantra, hou je stok goed vast, blijf zitten en doe vooral niks waardoor je uit de toon valt. Het was alsof het voltallige publiek uitsluitend naar mij keek, alsof ze wachten op het moment dat ik zou gaan gillen of met mijn stok zou gaan gooien. Ik had het gevoel of er uren passeerden voordat het eindelijk pauze was. In de kleedkamer hing een vrolijke stemming en er werd gebabbeld over wat er goed was gegaan en wat beter kon. Ik keek verbijsterd naar mijn collega's. Ik was in de afgelopen 3 kwartier bijna dood gegaan en de wereld was vergaan en ik snakte naar adem als een aangespoelde drenkeling. Had dan werkelijk niemand daar iets van gemerkt? Ik kan misschien... I would like to show you what happens when you have fear of performance while playing the violin. And I can illustrate that a bit for you. And
then
don't have the control anymore, and when you play really well delicate classical music, that's terrible, as you can imagine. Is that illustrating a bit what happens when you have a panic attack? Yeah, recognizable for some of you. There are some characteristics: irrational, catastrophic cognitions, meaning. I have this idea that you just come here to listen to me to see if I make a mistake. That's the reason why you're here. That's such a irrational, I hope, catastrophic cognition. Behavioral characteristics, so days before you have to go on stage, you are really feeling sick in your stomach, sleeping bad, etc. That's behavioral. Or for example, afterwards, you're so disappointed in yourself, you lock yourself in your room and you don't go out on the street anymore. And the physiological symptoms I illustrated already with the adrenaline physical effect. So let's go towards the end, and I would like to illustrate all my talking with some real patients, and it's also interesting that performance anxiety is not a diagnosis in itself. In the last decade, I've learned that it's often the symptom of an underlying problem you have to address, and that's why diagnostics are so important. I will illustrate that again with a patient, Rosanne, and it's also a nice illustration how the brain is actually working. I'm sorry for the Dutch. Rosanne 26 is een celliste met een mooie carrière in de Nederlandse wereld van de kamermuziek. Ze beleefde altijd erg veel plezier aan het optreden en had nooit last van podiumangst. Wel van een gezonde spanning van tevoren, maar daarover zei ze, dat hoort erbij en die kriebel in mijn buik vind ik juist wel fijn. Op een avond werd ze aangereden door een auto. Van het ongeluk herinnert ze zich niks meer. Na een korte ziekenhuisopname was ze lichamelijk hersteld en begon ze weer met optreden met haar strijkkwartet. Ze merkte echter dat ze last had gekregen van enorme heftige podiumangst. Zo ernstig zelfs dat ze in de pauze tijdens een concert besloot om niet meer verder te spelen en tot haar grote schaamte haar kwartetgenoten in de steek liet. Toen ze erover praatte in mijn spreekkamer barstte ze in tranen uit. Een muzikus speelt desnoods met zware griep. Alles is beter dan je medemuzici duperen. Dat is echt geen optie. Tijdens analyse kwamen erachter dat de adrenaline die ze eerst als prettig had ervaren voor een concert, sinds het ongeluk een hele andere betekenis had gekregen. Toen ze de auto op zich af zag komen, signaleerde haar brein logischerwijs dat ze in levensgevaar verkeerde. De adrenaline zorgde voor de bekende gevaarreactie. Het brein van Rosanne was dus niet meer in staat om de effecten van adrenaline als een onschuldig en zelfs prettig iets te ervaren, maar koppelde de release van dit stresshormoon sinds het ongeluk aan levensgevaar. Daarnaast waren de lichten op het podium ook nog eens een extra alarmsignaal voor haar brein geworden sinds de koplampen op haar afkwamen. Bij Rosanne gebeurde er iets bijzonders tijdens de traumabehandeling. Ze begon opeens te lachen terwijl ze met haar ogen dicht naar de tikjes luisterde. Dat is bij EMDR een speciale traumabehandeling wat je doet. Conform het protocol vroeg ik haar, hey, wat merk je, wat gebeurt er nu met je? En ze verraste me met haar antwoord, namelijk dat de koplampen die ze op zich af zag komen, het allernaarste beeld van die traumatische ervaring, in haar fantasie opeens lange wimpers kregen. Waardoor ze niet meer bedreigend waren, maar deden denken aan de lampen van een autootje uit een kinderfilm. Dit was de leuke manier van haar brein om het gevaar onschadelijk te maken, waardoor de gebeurtenis kon worden opgeruimd. Sinds de behandeling is haar podiumangst verdwenen en kan ze weer met haar oorspronkelijke enthousiasme en plezier optreden. So in fact it's an illustration of how the brain connects situations, emotions, messages in fact that cause this interesting trauma circle. So this traumatic event can also be a blackout on the stage. It doesn't matter. It's an event that really has a negative impact on your brain and is coded as dangerous. And then any related stimulus in the, well, let's say this koplampen, this lights of the car coming up to her, but also microphones when it happened, this blackout during a radio recording, the hippocampus, this memory center in your brain, is activated. And subsequently, the limbic system, the amygdala, the panic button, is also activated. And that causes fear, because you have to survive. And fear causes dysfunction, as I explained to you. And that, in fact, increases, reinforces this trauma circle. So go back on stage and just do it again is not always a good option, in fact, to do so. Another underlying cause for performance anxiety is depression. Depression is a very common disorder in our Western world, especially. And well, I think according to the World Health Organization, in the top three of disability-causing disorders. And I have the last patient in Dutch I would like to read to you to illustrate what happens when being depressed. Gerard is een veelgevraagd acteur, 60 jaar oud, die nog steeds enorm van zijn vak houdt, maar niet meer het podium op durft. Hij zegt altijd al een heel laag zelfbeeld te hebben gehad en sinds 10 jaar heeft hij steeds vaker last van blackouts op het toneel, die zo hevig werden dat hij uiteindelijk is ontslagen bij zijn toneelgroep. Werk voor radio en tv bezorgt hem geen klachten en vindt hij leuk om te doen, omdat het niet in één keer perfect hoeft. En daardoor is dit werk een stuk makkelijker voor hem. Gerard is erfelijk belast. Zijn zus is schizofreen en is al jaren opgenomen in een psychiatrisch ziekenhuis en zijn moeder had last van depressieve klachten. Omdat Gerard voldoet aan de criteria voor een depressie, zoals onder andere extreme somberheid, de concentratie- en geheugenstoornissen en gedachten aan zelfdoding, is hij ingesteld op medicatie. Opbouwen van de medicatie duurt een aantal weken, maar pas na ongeveer 3 maanden heeft hij het gevoel dat hij weer de oude is. Naast medicatie krijgt hij ook ondersteunende gesprekken en we proberen samen te kijken of hij iets van dagstructuur kan aanbrengen en wat activiteiten kan ontplooien die het genezingsproces ondersteunen, zoals bijvoorbeeld wandelen. Hij merkt aan alles dat de depressie is opgeklaard. Uiteraard zijn stemming, maar ook het feit dat hij weer zin heeft in seks. En daarnaast is hij bezig met het maken van plannen voor de toekomst, omdat hij gelukkig niet meer dood wil. Het mooiste vind ik de uitnodiging die op een dag in mijn postvakje ligt. Een optreden bij hem thuis, waarin hij een monoloog opvoert om te oefenen met op het podium staan. When looking at depression, it's in fact it's very logic that it compromises your functioning on a stage. There's this well continuous feeling of anxiety with many patients who are depressed, but there are also these cognitive problems, and they are less known than the depressive mood, but concentration, memory and mental slowing are very indicative for a depressive disorder, but also the thought disorders. You have this very low sense of being, in fact, sense of worthlessness, and your self-respect is really down in many cases when people are depressed. And that, of course, is very difficult to combine with an enthusiast functioning performance on stage. And the last one is the personality. As I already, explained to you, we have this group of people performing with these narcissistic personality traits, and I think that's important to address, because if you fail, if you are performing not in the way you expected from yourself, what's the impact on your self-image? If you give a lecture, if you present some scientific results and you didn't do so well, does it cause really this well, sense of worthlessness for days and days, or can you live with it? Do you deal with it? Or is the impact on your self-esteem actually too big? It's an important question to ask yourself. And I have some aanbevelingen or advices I would like to share with you, and then we are done. It's important to create a safe environment. We have the brain in order to survive, and the brain is there to detect danger for us. So when you go on stage, go check out before you have to perform. Go check what's the light, what's the people, the chairs, etc. So that it's not an unknown environment, because as we are animals, unknown environments are by definition dangerous. So check it out before you go on stage. The biological clock. If I study my concerto always at 10 o'clock in the morning and I have to perform at 8 o'clock at night, my muscles are different, my biological system reacts different. So study at the moment or perform at the moment you have to do it. And the bottom-up studying, I mean with that, we are very sensitive to failure. Our brain is very sensitive to that. So try to study in the way that you increase your ability instead of studying or performing in a way that you always will fail, because our brain really doesn't like to fail. And what I just said to you, the performance and self-image, what's the balance between it? Can you live with it? Can you accept that you're not always giving a 10 out of 10 or an A for the English-speaking people? And a very practical advice is, once you notice that you're really too anxious and the adrenaline level is too high, go running for a while. Go up and down the stairs in order to release this tension. And, well, I think your organism will really like if you do so. And I think that's a lot of information about the brain performing. And this is the book you might find interesting to read some things back. And thank you so much for your attention.
And thank you so much, Esther, for your lecture and for playing the violin.
Well, I was happy to do so.
Yes. You told us a lot about fears of failure with musicians, but I want to make it more general. And you showed the example of the TED Talk by Lisa Feldman-Barrett, and she had a very optimistic message: you can change your emotions. But how? And can you do it alone? Or do you need help? Can you give an answer?
That's an interesting question. Well, let's make a few comments about that. I think these very primordial emotions, fear, fight, freeze, that kind of emotions, the fast pathway, I think it's very hard to really change that yourself. The example of the patient who was hit by a car and had this association between fear, adrenaline, performing, it's very hard to deal with that yourself. I think you need professional help for that in many cases. On the other hand, I think we could be more conscious about why do we feel what we feel. So do you observe your body? Do you know what's your heart frequency, for example? And do you understand why you have this elevated heart frequency? Are you afraid or not? Or did there happen something before in this situation which my brain remembers and associates with danger? And that's more self-conscious way of dealing with that. On the other hand, your question is also interesting because I don't know the English word for what I'm going to say, but the maakbaarheidsgedachte, who knows what's it in English?
The maakbaarheidsgedachte, somebody with an English equivalent?
The idea of creation.
Yes, the idea that you can create yourself.
That's
and others, and society.
In society, that's a kind of prevailing idea that you can create anything if you just try hard. And also in line with my Flemish colleague Dirk de Wachter, I think misery, failing, is also part of our life. And the question is how we deal with that. So I'm enthusiastic about what Barrett suggests. Mm-hmm. And I think in specific cases, it's very important to try to do that, with or without help. But let's be really attentive that we don't get lost in this rat race, that everything we can create ourselves. And if it's not a 10 out of 10, we are failing. And that creates really a lot of problems, I see also with young people to coming to my clinic.
Coming back to what you said earlier, you said you have to feel what your body is doing, and you have to think why your body is reacting like that. But don't you need a little bit of help to feel and think?
Well, I think we are not really raised with a lot of knowledge about the brain, and the lecture I give you is actually basic knowledge about why do we have a brain, how does it function, and of course it's a limited version tonight, but mm-hmm. I think that should be part of education in school, in high school, that we know much more about what's the reaction of the brain to stress, what's my personal vulnerability, for example, in what situations do I react in an inadequate way, which mm-hmm. put me at the risk for, well, for example, depression, because my whole family is suffering from depression. So know thyself, is an important, mm-hmm. Well, I think, advice of the old thinkers. And I think it should be more part of our education. Very simple.
Okay, yeah. Yes. Also the education at a university?
What do you think?
What do you think, yes?
Do you know enough about your own brain, you think? No. It sounds a bit frustrated. Okay, brilliant. Yeah.
Okay, we have to improvise now a little bit. Can you please use this one, because I need a mic so we can hear what the public is saying. Yeah. Questions from you. Just raise your hand. Here you are.
Yeah, hi.
Hi.
Thank you for the wonderful presentation. And the question I want to ask is about depression. Everyone talks about the causes of depression and the effects of depression, but no one actually gives a practical way to come out of depression. And that is something which most of the people in their 20s suffer. It's because of the competition and, you know, the society and the peer pressure, everything.
Yeah.
So as a psychiatrist, what would be your practical solution for the youth who can come out of depression?
Well, that's an important and crucial question. And I'm thinking about an answer which is kind of satisfying, but not taking 1.5 hours. And well, depression is a mental disorder which is again caused partially by your genes and also big part by your stress environment, etc. When it's a really biological kind of depression, you often have to use medication. I mean, I don't like medication, but it's necessary then in order to function. And when you are cognitive really well compromised, you cannot profit from talking therapy, so then you need medication. But the question you ask is more about the stress, the environment in society. And I already mentioned this rat race. There are a few explanations, but you ask for tips, but I first give the explanations I think are really causing a lot of this suffering. It's this continuous 24 stimuli, which our brain is not used to that. I mean, we have more stimuli in 1 hour than in a year or 5 years in the Middle Ages, just a random comparison, but to give an idea. I think we have this terrible wat zijn uitkomstmaten in het Engels? Outcome measures. We want to be successful. We want to be nice. We want to be happy. And when someone comes to my office and I ask, what can I do for you? And the patient answers, I want to be happy again. Then I'm like, I cannot help you being happy. I can help you to function in that way that you can have a satisfying relationship, a job which fits you, etc. But all these very abstract outcome measures, they give the idea of failing all the time because you're never successful enough. So make that really clear for yourself. What's your personal outcome measure where you, make this appointment with yourself that you will be satisfied. Another thing is that the upbringing of children nowadays, I think our frustration tolerance is really limited. If I see how parents try to keep away all this failing from their children, I think in a way it's neglecting If you don't learn your child in a safe environment how to deal with failing. Because in the later, the big people world, they fail exams, relationships break up, and they're not used to it. They don't know how to deal with it. I see people coming to my office, and they get a severe depression because after 3 months, the boyfriend breaks up. And it's not fake. I mean, they're really depressed because they are not used to deal with frustration. And I think that's a very serious problem. And when everything is organized for you in order to succeed, and then you fail, then you really have a problem because you were not supposed to fail. But it's part of life. I mean, it's a bit simplistic maybe how I say it, but that's really my observation. And well, there are many psychiatrists who share the same observation. Is that an answer for now?
Other questions? Yes?
So you said like a lot of people want to be happy, for example, as an outcome measure. And I think it's natural because people are always looking for meaning in their lives. But you think that can be problematic. And I'm wondering, what would you replace it with when it's not happening? Like, what can people strive for, and what kind of meaning can they create?
I think that's a nice topic, because I think meaning is very crucial in order to have the chance to become happy. And I see happiness as a side effect of functioning, of well, be satisfied. And if you're lucky, then you might feel happy sometimes. But to go for being all the time happy, I think that's ridiculous. But meaning is important in order to achieve some moments of happiness. I sound a bit depressed, but I hope it's realistic. Yeah. As human animals, we have a certain manual, and I think we lost the manual a while ago. The menselijke maat, the human measure. I mean, we have these large systems where every individual have to be successful and is alone. And well, the social structures have been gone or are well brought back to very bare minimum. And I think that might be also causing the lack of meaning, the lack of, well, living according to the manual, which is the most optimal for us as a human being.
I will improvise. I saw a question. Yes, over there. If you could summarize the question.
The question is like, there is a contradiction because music is so healthy for your brain, but on the other hand, there's all these musicians with their psychiatric problems. How is it possible? I think that's an interesting, it's a tension between the two, because the music is so essential in order, as I said in the beginning, to channel emotions, to feel, experience emotions that probably are difficult in really daily life. But I think it's interesting to mention that there is a study from Scandinavia where they researched families with the big psychiatric disorders like bipolar disorder, schizophrenia, etc. And they found, they have to replicate it, but the first impression is that in families with a lot of psychiatric disorders, there are significant more artists. So there is a link between being psychiatrically troubled, and being creative. And I think it might have to do with association, and well, that's the hard life of an artist. I think it's terrible to be an artist in some way. And just imagine how they would feel if they don't have the music. Could that be an answer to you? And the therapeutic effects of music, well, I hope they will do more research and implement that in daily practice, because now it's a bit, well, it's methodologically very difficult to research that. But I think music is a very healthy phenomena which can really benefit for people in general, actually.
A question. You love classical music because you played it. I assume that you love classical music. Is that correct?
Now, when we talk about attribution, I'm raised in a very decent religious environment.
Yes.
And it was forbidden to listen to pop music, actually.
Okay.
I had to listen to Bach all the time. that's, you have to have a reason to become a psychiatrist. But But sometimes I was really naughty, and yes. I listened to pop music.
Okay.
And I'm have a bit of a personality where I love the things that are forbidden. So yes. Pop music is attributed for me as something like a forbidden fruit or something. So uh-huh. I love to listen to pop music and not classical music.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Okay. I see. Yes. Thank you. other questions? Yes. Can you do you have a strong voice? Yeah. Just shout. When you are alone and when you think, well, I'm going to do that on stage, and then when you are on stage, for example, you just think, oh no, no. And all your thoughts are gone.
That's a nice question. I mean, I know this idea like, oh, I'm, at home I'm the genius, and then you go on stage and you're, well, just mediocre or something. And I think an important part of preparing that is the preparation. So practice at home, just say the sentences out loud so that you're not on stage with all this new stimuli, a lot of danger. I'm against the group, and that's evolutionary dangerous, and it's new, and I don't know you, and it's a lot of dangerous stimuli, in fact. And if I then have to reproduce my genial thoughts or whatever, then you ask a lot of yourself. So once you prepare that at home, and I really, I mean it seriously, like preparing in front of the mirror, say it out loud, then you cut down the amount of new stimuli and you can rely back on that. You can rely on that a lot better than if you have to do that, in fact, improvise that on stage. It's a very practical tip, but I hope you can do something with it. Because it's a pity if you cannot transform or transmit, I mean, your ideas to the public. And that's the interesting thing about adrenaline, I forgot to say, but adrenaline is also nice because it helps you to perform, it helps you to focus and to give meaning to what you're telling or doing. So adrenaline is also your friend, but it also changes a bit your biochemistry, and that is also new, so dangerous. Yeah?
Another practical point, you mentioned that when you are have to perform, on a certain moment, let's say in the evening, that it's better to study in the evening because then your clock, your biological clock, is fits. Can you also apply that to making an exam at university? Because when you have to do an exam, students have to do a lot of exams nowadays. If you have to do it at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, is it best to study in the afternoon?
Well, that's interesting. I think the answer would be yes, but it depends on your personal sensitivity to the biological effects, in fact. Because some people, they don't notice so much from their different states during the 24-hour cycle. But for some people, it might be really crucial. So if you're sensitive to that, well, check out how you feel at 2 o'clock in the afternoon and what you should do, or you should go for a walk before, or you should sleep before. That's very personal to find out, but that's being conscious about who you are, what's your personal manual, in fact.
Okay. Other questions? Oh, yes, I want to go to you with my mic, but I don't have a mic anymore.
Yes, so what you mentioned is that there's a pretty big taboo.
Right, I mean, I have this a brilliant student, part of a fraternity club, and she looks like a goddess and perfect, and nobody knows that she's very severely depressed. But in my office, she tells me, I don't want to live anymore. I really want to kill myself. And she cannot share it because she's so afraid that people will really drop her. Or the other singer, she didn't dare to go on vacation with her mother because she was afraid that her mother would find the antidepressive medication in the hotel room. So I have to say that the people who have enough courage, I don't like the word, but to share it, that they often heal faster, because sharing it with your environment often is not as terrible and dangerous as you think. And well, it benefits the process of healing, and that's why it's so important. And it brings me to another point, that to fight the taboo on mental illnesses, we have all these campaigns, like we have to talk about it and we have to share it. But I think it's important to have knowledge, and the war on cancer by Kennedy, 60s last century, was also, well, it was effective because people knew what cancer was about. They knew the symptoms. And that's the same with, for example, neurological attacks. When your mouth is hanging, you know, oh, then I have to go to the hospital, it might be neurological. And the same is with depression. I mean, we have to talk about depression. What do you need to talk about if you don't know what are the symptoms? So I really advise everyone, and that's also part of my mission. We have the depression ball every year, Depressie Gala, in order to raise not only awareness, but also to increase knowledge. There are 9 symptoms of depression. It's not only just being sad or depressed, it's all these other symptoms as well. Mm-hmm. And you have to recognize it within yourself, but also with your loved ones or your people you're working with. I think that's important. It's a bit of a kind of broad answer to your question, but...
It was a broad question.
Thank you.
Yes, over there.
It's a little bit about... One of my motives to start a political party. It's not Beter NL, but NL Beter.
Oh, sorry.
But that's one of the things, because there are initiatives, but it's difficult, and they are random, and if you're lucky, you encounter it. But it's not a standard thing, and I think it should be really implemented in our education. And yes, I'm willing to participate in any initiative, but it should work, and it should not just be a year, but it should be really part of the standard education. I think it's very important. That's a very important question, because that's really a risk. Eh? Like, oh, you have to know yourself, you have to go to India to find yourself. And I have never met anyone finding himself or herself, and I don't know what it would do if you find yourself, actually. Maybe it's better not to find yourself. You don't know what you will meet. But I think there is exactly what you say. There is a balance between your activities, your schedule, your discipline. I think discipline is also a very important virtue or parameter. And I think this manual is not so complicated. It means that you not have to sit 8 hours on your telephone. I made this mentale schijf van 5, mental, what's Engels?
Mental manual? Manual of 5?
Well,
yes,
there's
but
a,
it, yeah. This is not about food, well, but about mental health. Yes, yes.
Rules of the well, rules 5 of mental yes. rules of life. We have this for food and etc. And connect at least a few times a day or one time a day. It depends how your personality is, with other people. Exercise. All these very basic things, and they sound really boring and annoying if I say it, but people don't do it. They sit on the couch. They're on their phone, they feel terrible, they have perhaps a depression, they ask me for a antidepressive medication, and then they wait until they will feel better. And I think we have a big responsibility, and I don't want to sound really too strict or something, but we can do so much ourselves. And just finding yourself or sensing who you are, etc. I think it should be always balanced by these activities, which are well proven to be healthy, in fact. I mean, don't forget where we come from, the jagers-verzamelaars, the early days of mankind. Just that's how our brain is actually wired. And we are not evaluated for this society with all these stimuli, with all these temptations, the solitudes, because we are very lonely, in fact, not only old people, but also young people. And it's very unhealthy. I mean, there are studies showing that being lonely is even more unhealthy than smoking.
That's the same what Machtelt Huber said this afternoon during her lecture about positive health.
Yeah, and yes. That's exactly, I think she has a lot of interesting thoughts about it, and they are proven, and I agree with that. And solitude, avoiding that is an important one, yeah.
Yes. I looked at your mental schijf van 5. And if I translate it very quickly in English, it is take enough physical exercise, not always running, but just take the stairs instead of the elevator, for example. Take time for social contacts, talk about problems, be sure that you take enough rest, lummelen, so don't do anything but just be... Well, lummelen. that's the. I don't know the English word for lummelen.
Hanging around.
hanging around, just hanging around. And a practical one, don't use your phone too much. Why aren't we allowed, or why do you suggest that we don't use our phone too much?
Well, because there are many signals that the mobile phone causes a really addiction problem. And it's logical, because all these likes and stimuli, they stimulate the reward center in our brain, just the same as cocaine. And there are many studies, especially under young people, which are really concerning, because you see these symptoms of addiction, like feeling empty, being depressed, thinking about killing yourself, severe symptoms, mm-hmm. which are actually just symptoms of addiction, amongst other ones as well. Why should we and go on with being addicted and taking the risk of getting really depressed or anxious or?
Yes. Okay. One last question, because you are one of the founders of NL Beta. Do I say it correctly now? Why?
Well, that
short answer.
Short.
Why NL Beta?
I'm a medical doctor, and I became a doctor, I did the oath of Hippocrates to take care of my patients and to do anything within my possibility to help and to take care that they will be healthy and have a good life. That sounds big, but it is big, I think. As a medical doctor now in the Netherlands, it's not possible to change a system which is really failing. And as a psychiatrist, I see people on waiting lists. I see very, very vulnerable psychiatric patients not getting the help they need. I see on the intensive care parents with their daughter who just tried to kill herself with an overdose, and the parents are crying and telling me, but what can we do? Because she's on a waiting list and she has to wait for 6 months and she will try again to kill herself. Mm-hmm. So what can I do? I mean, I write my opinion pieces. I sometimes do things in the media. I'm happy when I'm on the radio, television, talking about it. Sometimes there is this political figure in Den Haag listening to me or asking a question in the Tweede Kamer, but nothing changes. So the system is not prone to change, and the system is organized, the health system, is organized in a way that, and it's not by purpose, but the interests are in such a way that it's not possible to change it as a doctor in the way that we tried. So we don't see any option but going to Den Haag and see if we can do something. At least we try.
Okay, do you have time for it?
No. No, because I have to leave my patients partially.
Yes.
And I think that's a very severe thing to
do. That's also the oath of Hippocrates. Yes.
Yeah. So that's a very difficult decision to make. I will never stop seeing my patients, but you have to make choices. And
yes.
I hope that will be beneficial for more patients than I can do now.
Yes. And you will never stop playing the violin, I suppose.
No, because I have to channel my emotions.
Yes. Okay. I want to thank you very much for your lecture and for your practical suggestions. First, a warm hand to Esther van Venema.